Good evening, everybody. My name is Shiroki Adegari. I am a faculty, I'm a member of the faculty at the Department of Music, and I have the absolute pleasure to welcome you to this year's Best of ICAM. The ICAM program is an interdisciplinary major, and the students go through a collection of courses ranging from music, visual arts, electrical engineering, computer science, cognitive science, and many other. And the Best of ICAM is the work that the senior students have done in the past 6 months. But in fact, one could say that this is a work that they have been doing for many, many years, and we have the honor and the privilege to work with them. It's been absolutely a great experience to be with them the past 6 months, and the projects are truly fantastic, and I know you will enjoy them very much. Shlomo Dubnov, this has been the work of two different sections, and Professor Dubnov, if you have something to share with us, we can then jump into
the video. So good evening, everybody, and yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sharik, so much for the introduction of ICAM. Mm-hmm. So this is our celebration of finishing not only a year long of or two quarters long of the project that kind of summarizes and, you know, culminates the whole ICAM major. I think we'll have an incredible showcase here of a variety of skills, from creative to research to anything that combines basically what computing in the arts means. So I think without any further delay, I would like maybe to pass the baton to Jessica, right? You'll be the one conducting the presentation. And I would like to thank also, of course the students, but Jessica and the whole production team for putting together this show. So thank you so much, and welcome everybody.
Yeah, just to add one last thing to it, as we are watching, you're watching on YouTube. After every four pieces, we come back to Zoom. So we'll be able to address any questions that you may have. So please type them in the chat. We'll be monitoring those and we'll address any discussions you may would like us to have. We'll spend a few minutes after every four piece.
Hello, I'm Kyle Bowman, and for my senior project, I was exploring how to control games using only sound. So my goals for this project were really A, to show off my programming ability, B, to try to analyze the properties of sound and see how I can map them to other actions, and therefore allow someone to use a computer program using only a microphone. And lastly, I wanted to create some sort of musical interactive experience with code, with technology, within a video game. So this experiment was really to create a game that can be played using music as an input. In order to do that, I needed to use a DSP engine to process sound and some way to connect the DSP and game engines together using network messages. In order to do that, I designed this system where we can capture and process sound using pure data, use open sound control to send messages over the network to our game engine processing. I designed a system which took input from your microphone, processed it using pure data, looking for special events that we could map to different interactions within a game, create messages for those events that can be sent over the network, and finally create a game engine that can process those event messages and then use them within the game. So for the design of the game, I figured that I ought to start out simple and build out to something more complex. I started with looking towards games that I've already played, and one that stood out to me was Flappy Bird. In Flappy Bird, the player controls the height of the bird over time, while the game places obstacles in their way, which motivates the user to engage with the controls. In my game design, I decided to take a similar approach, but I used pitch to map the height of the player on the screen. So playing a higher pitch would allow the player to move up, and a lower pitch would allow the player to move down. This way they could avoid obstacles and try to grab bonuses within the game. In addition to pitch, the game considers more percussive sounds by analyzing the sound and looking for sharp attacks. This way, the player can clap their hands or snap their fingers to launch projectiles, which will then destroy the obstacles that are in their path, allowing them more freedom to move about the game environment. This means that I needed a two-prong approach in my audio processing. First, we need to connect to the OSC server, then we activate the microphone, and then we send the audio stream to two different processors. One will analyze pitch and send pitch messages telling the game how high or how low the player should be on the screen. And the second process will analyze the attacks and tell the game when the player wants to fire a missile. After a message is created, it is packed and sent over the network using the UDP protocol. Now that we have the rules and inputs defined for the game, we can start making the game itself. For a theme, I decided to choose sci-fi, simply because it sounded kind of cool at the time. So the name is a combination of stars and karaoke. It is Starioke. The game engine works like this. First, within processing, we need to initialize the Open Sound Control server. Then we need to initialize the game elements. Things like initial positions, status indicators, and image assets. Then we activate the game loop. Within the game loop, we basically just draw all the elements and then update their stats. This loops on over and over until the game ends. So here's a brief overview of the entire system. We start off with a microphone. The microphone sends that data into Pure Data. Pure Data processes the audio and then creates open sound control messages and sends them over the network using the UDP protocol. The OSC server is running within processing on the localhost address on port 32,000. This means that you could, in theory, play this game remotely, where a microphone and Pure Data is running on a computer somewhere and is sending UDP messages over the internet to a computer running the game engine somewhere else in the world. Because we're using Open Sound Control instead of sending the raw audio data, the latency would be really low, because sending text is a lot easier than sending real-time audio. I recorded a cover of myself playing When I'm Gone from the movie Pitch Perfect. That way I can demonstrate the game's musical potential. I chose this piece because it consists of two main elements used in Starioke, pitch and percussion. I recorded the session and mixed it within Ableton.
I got my ticket for the long way round, two bottles of whiskey for the way, and I sure would like some sweet company, and I'm leaving tomorrow, what do you say? When I'm gone, when I'm gone, you're gonna miss me when I'm gone. You're gonna miss me by my hair, you're gonna miss me everywhere, oh, you're gonna miss me when I'm gone. I got my ticket for the long way round, one with the prettiest of views. It's got mountains, it's got rivers, it's got sights to give you shivers, but it sure would be prettier with you. When I'm gone, when I'm gone, you're gonna miss me when I'm gone. You're gonna miss me by my walk, you're gonna miss me by my talk, oh, you're gonna miss me when I'm gone.
In conclusion, I was able to build a system that functions across platforms, create a game that can be played using only sound, and designed a musical experience using code. Thank you, and I hope you enjoyed the project.
Hello, my name is Haley Brown, and for my senior project, I sound designed the play Trojan Women, written by the Greek tragedian Euripides and translated by Dr. Marianne McDonald. This show was produced by the UCSD Theater and Dance Department and directed by UCSD Emeritus Professor Charlie Oates. Taking place after the Trojan War, this story focuses on Hecuba, the late Queen of Troy. Herself and the other women reflect on the immense loss they have experienced and how it will impact the rest of their lives. They have watched their city burn, loved ones be killed, but it is their perseverance and ability to find hope that centers this play. As the sound designer, I created the sonic world of the piece. One of the biggest challenges I've faced while designing shows virtually is creating an immersive environment. Building a new world becomes considerably more difficult when there's no shared location, both for your audience and your actors. This is something that my fellow designers and I continuously questioned when creating the world of Trojan Women. Once I started working on this project, I spent many hours immersed in research. I learned about the Trojan War, Euripides' writing style, as well as spent many hours reading and rereading the play. The first conversations I had with Charlie, our director, weren't specific to sound. We discussed characters, themes, and pivotal moments in the show. The next step was to establish the principles of my design. It was important to ensure that the director and I were on the same page when it came to the look and the feel of the world. I started creating short sound collages that corresponded with characters and moments in the show, which opened up a dialogue between Charlie and myself. The sound design for the show utilized both naturalistic and synthesized elements. One signifier of Euripides' work is his use of long and elegant monologues. These moments we get to deep dive into the characters' minds and their personalities shine through. I underscored these with a drone that would mirror what the characters were feeling at the moment. As the characters were then brought back to the harsh realities of their situation, the soundscape would violently shift back to the naturalistic elements, a reminder that the Greek gods had not favored the Trojans. I'm now going to play a piece for you that encapsulates some of the ideas of my design. While the tale of the Trojan War is thousands of years old, the horrors of war and the abuse suffered on account of those in power is still present today. We start in a modern bedroom.
There is a version of Trojan women happening everywhere.
Not just Syria, Myanmar, Armenia, or El Salvador.
Everywhere. Here.
This is what started the war.
They say Helen's to blame for it all. It's convenient to blame a woman. But actually, it was men greedy for power and wealth.
Tell the truth. Where would you get in politics doing that? Helen was just an excuse.
In death, there is nothing.
Bomb the bitch.
In life, there is hope.
Stop that whore.
There's no limit to my suffering.
Your child, Polyxena, is dead.
One wave crashes, another follows.
Bomb the bitch! Stop that whore!
Hope has fled.
Bomb the bitch!
Forgive me.
Stop that whore.
We are women. We are peacemakers. We are prisoners.
In death, there is nothing. In life, there is hope.
I have often been told that the convergence of two seemingly opposing ideas can result in the conception of a third new idea. However, perhaps the creation of new ideas are not based upon complete reconciliation, but within the spaces that are formed by the rhythmic interplay of these forces over time. The Automaton Project is the result of a curious dance between the frequently inharmonious forces of logic and emotion. Deriving its logical structure from the study of systems and its emotional flow from the concept of minimalism, Automaton has arrived at a point in which it raises new questions about the ways in which humans interact with systems and processes. By taking on the form of a gesture-based interactive website, the project allows for the exploration of logical structures through the emotionally driven lens of audiovisual feedback. The structure of the piece is built around a specific system known as cellular automata, which is characterized by a grid of cells, each containing a neighborhood and a potential state. A numeric rule governs the creation of new generations of the entire grid based upon the specific qualities of each cell. A collection of these systems are organized into one cohesive program, which then maps cell states to specific musical and visual qualities and ultimately performs a unique experience based upon AI recognition of gesture commands by the program user. Although Automaton is one of various possible entry points for this kind of interaction, it exists in a newly forming space which questions the very ways in which we create and interact.
I grew up in LA, and I think that tells you a lot, just sort of the amount of culture and influences around you really can give a really big artistic impression. For me, I spent a lot of time in the marching band, jazz band in my high school, just, you know, competing, doing it for the sake of music. And that's really what got me into it, I'd say. Branching off from that, doing my own thing, starting with just, you know, GarageBand for iOS on my phone. I think that's what really got me started. Learning about people like Steve Lacy, who composed a lot of stuff, won a Grammy, and still just using his phone. That's what really got me into starting to believe in myself a little bit more and getting me to where I am right now. For me, this album, really, it's about finding my artistic voice and what it means to really write, compose, sing, collaborate, produce, master all these different tracks, because that really takes, you know, a lot of connection with yourself, I feel, to make it so that it all makes sense really at the end. And throughout the process, I really didn't know what was going to make sense, but I think looking back on it, that whole process is really what this EP symbolizes for me. My entire process of discovering a feeling, a mood, a sound. First you draw Bible, which I think is one of my more rhythmic pieces. It features a lot of cadences on it, really strict rhythms. The song's really just about really being confident in yourself and what you want to do and purposeful in a specific moment in time. I make a choice and then it's final. Make a killing like it's portal. I know I'm ready and that's what's vital. So the next track really blows. And this one, really what I wanted to set out with is just create this really big ambient, like orchestral feeling. Just a bunch of delay and reverb on a lot of these things. And there's some play between sort of like these natural sounding strings and then these more synthetic sounding ones. And in terms of the storyline of this one's really about chance and fate, sort of where you lie in society, how that impacts your position, whether you wish you were somewhere else, and how much better it could be, or if it really would just be the same. And that's really what that song's about. You get what you get, no certainty, so learn to be hopelessly infatuated with currency or some other form of novelty. Just know we're living mortally, and this is coming truthfully. No room for any empathy. For the third track, Clear Skies Part 2, this one's actually a pretty interesting process. Started out with a sample, one of the artists I collaborated with sent to me. Ended up turning it into a whole song for her, and out of that spawned this really cool sample that I used on this track. And that sample is it really demonstrates sort of like this past time that I'm reflecting on in all of my vocals. You can really tell there's a lack of closure over an incident that happened that, you know, never really let me recover, because I never really let it go, and it calcified over time. And that's sort of what you're hearing throughout the song, just a fight between me fighting the past with the present. I never saw past my regrets to see a home and not another threat. What could have been most fortunate? So the last song, this is one that really gets me my most vulnerable, I think. Just writing this song was a hard process of reflecting on a person in my life that I had to let go, but not with any sort of spite or anger, really just sadness, because this person who contributed so much to my life at a point, I had to leave behind, and I would never forget them or take for granted what they've done. But it's something that I just had to let go.
Thank you for all those. We didn't have many questions on the chat, but if you have any questions here among ourselves, please go ahead and ask. JP, I had one question. I was looking at your video. The gestures are controlling both the audio and the video, correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
And how do you decide on how the movement happened on the video? I think on the music, perhaps that you pick up a pentachord and you move between those. How do you decide on the visuals?
Yeah, we just shot for like probably like 45 minutes and then just kind of picked out different clips that we thought would kind of look good together and then just like kind of stitched it all up together. Let's see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the questions for the group. Okay, I guess we can go to the... Oh, there is a question? Just heard something.
No, I was just wondering if people would like to share the maybe some of the creative process they went through. I mean, this is a general question. Anybody who thinks that, you know, the experience of building such an elaborate project, and some are research projects, some are musical productions. Yeah, if anybody would like to jump in now or later on, I think... some of you, of course, explained this during the presentation, but during the chat, I think that would be interesting to share.
I guess we're a little Zoom shy, perhaps, you know, this
yes.
is a pandemic effect. And, one question I had, Omar, is your music available on streaming services right now?
So that was the plan, but I still have to... tweak some things still. I can put in my Spotify link, I'm pretty sure, but it's not up yet.
I see. Yeah, I guess we can searching with your name, we should be able to find it. Haley, there's a question for you from Bobby. Could you share the types of sounds you used for your score? I hear wind. What else was in there?
Hi. Yeah, so for the music underneath the piece, specifically in kind of like those monologues I talked about, I had an oscillator that I had kind of adapted in Ableton, and then I had a wind sample that I threw in a sampler and then could kind of pitch that. And then that was how I would kind of shape the mood for those specific moments. And then as you heard, there's like a drumming sound that comes in one moment of the play. Kind of like the most intense moment, I would say. So it just kind of like heightened the senses. And so that was why we had chosen to do that. And then we had a music director for the show who had the idea for the chime that you hear at the beginning that also kind of plays for a funeral ceremony later in the play. So those were kind of the sounds I was playing with for those moments. But yeah, it was... I don't know. It was a unique experience composing with non-traditional, I guess, like instruments and making it all fit together with the other designer's concept for the world. But I think we did a good job in the end. But yeah.
And your piece was around an hour and 20 minutes, right?
Yeah, the play production. An hour and 20, yeah.
Okay, great. Yes, please. So.
All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Levi Falk. This is my Best of ICAM presentation. For my senior project, I started a little record label called Polluted Records. I have been handling the releases for five artists so far. Pretty Pollution, The Derelict, Since You Were Me, Rendezvous with the Devil, and Omar. Omar is the artist named for Omar Flores, another student in this class. You should go check out his presentation as well. To dive in, some of the releases I've had so far, I'm not going to go over all of them in too much depth, but it amounts to an EP, a full-length album, a remix, and seven different singles. Here's a little taster of some of the cover art from those releases. This is for The Derelict. This was for the remix that I just mentioned. This is for a Pretty Pollution track. This is for Rendezvous with the Devil. This is Omar's release art for his single and the EP I just mentioned. And the last track to come out was a track called Acrasia for Since You Were Me. In addition to those releases, which I want to point out, with the exception of Omar's track, all of it was exclusively composed, mixed, produced, what have you, by me. So it was kind of a big undertaking. In addition to all of the record label stuff, I've also been writing and producing all of this music myself. The other thing I wanted to point out is I performed in Eddie Ontiveros' senior project, which was the Back to Reality live stream, which was a pre-recorded live stream that we just aired a couple days ago as of us watching this on Tuesday, with Rendezvous with the Devil, in addition to Braulio, another student in this class as well. So, some of my upcoming work, a new artist called The Second Time This Week, a remix of the Omar song that I just mentioned, a British artist called Frequency Creature is in the middle of remixing a Pretty Pollution track, which I'll actually be playing in a moment. I'll also be releasing Omar's senior project, which was a handful of, I guess we're going to do two EPs. And then my Back to Reality live stream set I'll be releasing as a live album, as well as an EP for Rendezvous with the Devil as well. Some of the promotional work I've been doing, in addition to the just releasing everything, I've had airplay on a Texas radio network with 100,000 plus some monthly listeners. Obviously performing in the Back to Reality live stream and the remix that I just mentioned as well. And I have an upcoming interview with an indie zine called Today's After Party that I'm very excited about. So, the part where you listen to my music, I'm going to play an extended clip from Pretty Pollution song, and then also show a bit from Eddie's live stream. That'll do it for me. Thank you so much for tuning in, everyone. Please go watch everyone else's performance. And thank you so much.
Hi,
My name is Cameron Haywood, and I am a fourth year ERC student. I've been an ICAM major since my second semester of my first year. And for my senior project, I composed, produced, and performed an EP titled Buffer Time. I titled it Buffer Time because a lot of the time that's what I describe my college experience as. It's kind of like a loading period where you are going through like journeys of self-discovery, learning who you are and how to like believe in yourself and be confident in what you can do. And it's kind of like a loading period from being a young adult and going and starting your life and your professional career. And so that's why I titled it Buffer Time. And this first song that I'm going to show is called Calypso. So I produced this song like early 2021, and I wrote it. I went to the beach one day to watch the sunset, and I decided to dedicate the song to the ocean because I love to swim, and I learned to surf like back in fall of last year. And so yeah, that's like the inspiration behind this song, and it's like really fun and like lighthearted and laid back. So I hope you enjoy it.
Shot off just like a gun. In a day, I see your face on everyone. I'm ablaze, my soul's on fire, hot as the sun. All the world fades away when I'm looking at your face. I keep an eternity reveling in your grave. I think I'm on Calypso.
The next song that I'm going to show is called Medieval. So it actually started as a loop that I found online. And when I heard it, it like immediately reminded me of this venue in LA called Medieval Times, where basically people dress up in armor and like they fight in this pit and you eat like roasted chicken and it's like a whole experience. So it's like it's an instrumental dance track, no lyrics. And yeah, I made it and it was inspired by Medieval Times, and I really love like Medieval Times films and fight scenes. So yeah, that's the inspiration behind this. So here it is. The last song that I'm going to be showing you all today is a song called Remember. And I wrote this song like in the original set of songs that I wrote for this EP. I wrote maybe like 24 songs before I got to the ones that I really liked. And this one almost didn't make the EP, but I was singing it to myself one week, like back in March. And I was kind of like, why wouldn't I put this song on here? It's one of my favorite songs that I've written. And it's a lot heavier than the other songs that I've showed today, but it's a really good one. So I hope you enjoy it.
Remember you said you loved me and you took my hand and you told me that till the end. I was your one and only, like Robin and Marianne. And I know it's my fault that you found another man, but I hope you think about me and know that I understand that what we had was true love, and I'll never feel it again. So I won't say I'm sorry.
Instruments are called the taegeum, the seogeum, and the danso. These photos are actually taken by myself, by the way. All of them are Korean traditional wood instruments, and actually they are quite widely played in South Korea. Almost all of the elementary school students learn how to play the seogeum or the danso. I also learned how to play danso when I went to elementary school in South Korea. However, I found that there were no taegeum, seogeum, danso virtual instruments on the market. I know that there were some researches about it going on, but there were no commercial products for them, especially the ones for English speakers. So I decided to make one.
This is the taegeum virtual instrument. And this is the seogeum virtual instrument. And this is the danso virtual instrument.
So let me explain how I recorded a sample of the instrument. Basically, I recorded with three microphones, and one microphone was placed close to the mouth of the instrumentalist, and I used Neumann UA7 for it. And another microphone was placed far away from the mouth, but close to the instrument, and I used Neumann UA7 for it too. Additionally, I used a pair of Shops CMC65 for the stereo recording, and you can choose what samples to be played by this huge knob.
You need to have a Kontakt or Kontakt player for using the instrument. You can download Kontakt player for free in Native Instrument website. This instrument supports 7 articulations that are actually played by the taegeum, the seogeum, and the danso players. These include basic articulation, staccato, trill, thick tremolo, light tremolo, portaim in a fall, portaim in a rise. And you can add reverb or phaser if you click the toggles. Finally, I will turn on the track that was made with the Degen virtual instrument. When turning on this track, I will show the website that I made for the publication.
Looking at my watch and it's about that time. Looking at my watch and it's about that time. You're moving straight to the music, of course. So shake it side to side and back and forth. Something that they didn't imagine or even fathom how I come back from the bad realm. I'm at the helm of this here ship. The captain, if you call me, taking y'all on a trip. Know that I will always just come through. Lyrical kung fu, now watch what my tongue do. Looking at my watch and it's about that time. Looking at my watch and it's about that time. Looking at my watch and it's about that time. Looking at my watch and it's about that time.
Hello guys, my name is Jing Lam. Today I'm presenting to you my senior project, which is a sort of combination of research, project, and tutorials regarding the topic of sounds and game. So, something about myself. I have double major in cognitive science and I can music. I'm graduating this quarter, and currently I'm working in again industry, and that's why I chose this topic for my senior project. The music in games can really create an immersive experience that is more than purely listening to your favorite music, but you can freely explore in another world. After evaluating the workload and my capability, unfortunately, I decided not to aim for a complete experience creation of a game world. Instead, I would like to consider this project as my first step towards it, as well as my learning process of necessary game production knowledge. So what's my project? Let's get into it. This is an individual project. I make all the sound sources by myself, but use the open source Unity project game called Faith. The body of my project is a website of the tutorial on making game music on Unity. Here are the softwares that I used in my project, which are Ableton, Unity, and Fmode. I use Ableton for my main music composition process. I also directly use Ableton to record some sound samples for the character's footsteps. Unity is a commercially used engine that allows multiple ways of modeling, rendering, scene design, and system integration, and etc. You can do each of them either on Unity or separately and then put them all together to produce a complete game experience within this engine. And Fmode is a new thing I learned throughout the process, but not very sufficient. Well, still enough for this project. I would consider it as something like a DJ station that you can store your work and make adjustments to it as you perform in your game in Unity. Here is a concise flowchart of how these things connected and how they work together. Here is a brief view of the flow if you did not use Fmode. Now I will just scroll over the webpage here with you guys to give you an idea of how it looks like after adding all the details to the tutorial. The order that the sessions are arranged in the website follows the flowchart, so please refer to the flowchart in the website to better understand the process. You feel like visiting it by yourself. To save some time, I doubled the speed of the video here, but you can always visit the website by yourself. Finally, let me show you the game demo example. Unfortunately, I was unable to demonstrate the whole experience in this presentation because of the time limits. But feel free to visit my website to see the tutorial and try to make a GAN music by yourself, or download the GAN examples by scanning the QR code to try it by yourself.
Wow, what wonderful range of pieces. Really amazing. Questions? I know everybody was asking, how can we get these? Maybe every one of you should repeat your website, the name of the website, or ways to get either get to your pieces or get what you've created. Levi, you want to go one more time? Tell us how people can get your music.
Yep, I am pulling up a Spotify link right now, and I'll drop it in the YouTube chat in just a second.
I'm going to put the link in the chat too.
Yeah, please do. I guess everybody wanted.
Yeah, also for the presentation that just the immersive game, I didn't get the QR code before it went off the screen. So I don't know if...
Yeah, Jing, if
there's a link for that or not.
Yeah, I think Jing, could you put the link in the chat? But just letting everybody know that these videos will be available on the music website, so you could go back and visit them if you don't find them now. But I'm hoping that we're going to get those links right now in the YouTube chat.
If I could talk about Jing's project as well. So obviously it's in this video game style, and somebody who plays a little bit of video games myself, I don't know if this was emphasized, but I don't know how far you are going to be doing this. I don't know if you were going to get like an overarching story eventually later on, or if you were going to get levels eventually, that type of thing. It would just kind of be interesting to see where you kind of want to go with this in the future.
Maybe Jing can't hear us, or no, she did. Oh, her microphone is not working. Jing's microphone is not working, so she can only type. Any other questions? Cameron, please let us know how we can get your music as well. Fantastic, beautiful voice music. I'm actually wondering how you usually come up with pieces. What are your inspirations, even though you explained a little bit, but musically you go really amazing places.
Oh, thank you. Well, I'll put my Instagram link in the chat, because I'll have updates, like, because I'm releasing it next Wednesday, so I'll have updates the days leading to it. Yeah. As far as inspirations, I don't know. I would say for the a cappella song, James Blake was a big inspiration for that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And like Pharrell, and like a lot of different artists mixed together.
Thank you. I'm just going to read Jing's comments as well. Said, but in the future, I'm working as a project manager for games. I use open source game demo for this project, and I'm learning development process with it. Hopefully I'll have a better understanding on games overall in the future, but may not develop this one further, unfortunately. Oh. Mm-hmm. Take it away, Jessica.
So my project is called Codaphone, and basically it's a web app where the user can enter some Python code into this box right here, and it'll produce not only a visual representation, but also an auditory representation of the program in execution. So I wrote a little bit about my project here, but basically the gist of it is that it's kind of fascinating to me that we can represent programs in all different types of ways, but almost all these models rely on a visual element. So I felt like it would be really interesting to use sound to represent the execution of the program. So the goal is that when you can hear the sounds as well as seeing the visual elements as the program runs, the auditory stimuli will kind of enhance the overall sensory experience and reinforce the concepts that you would be able to learn through understanding the program. And I don't know if the sounds actually do add anything in this way, since that's kind of hard to measure. But even if not, it's still kind of cool to have an auditory representation of a program, since, as far as I know, nobody has really done that yet. So I'm going to run a simple example to show that. Yeah, so maybe you can hear that there's a different sound for things like creating a variable, doing arithmetic, getting the value of a variable. And so now here's another example. It's definitely a lot longer, but there are a lot of different things going on in it. So let's run that. So a lot of the sounds that I chose were kind of arbitrary since most of these things don't really have sounds associated with them. Like, I don't know how a list on appearing on the heap is supposed to sound like, you know, but there were a few sounds that I did actually come up with logically using different musical concepts. And the one that I want to talk about is stack frames. So there's this picture here that exists to represent the different stack frames in a program over time. So I kind of tried to replicate that in my project using harmonics. So similar to how a box is added in this picture at the time that a stack frame is created and then it's removed accordingly, I added a harmonic to the overall background sound whenever there was a new stack frame and removed it when the stack frame was removed. So that was kind of my attempt to replicate this sort of picture in sound. So over time, you can hear a stack frame being added or removed. And so there are some more intricate reasons for why I think that these stack frame harmonics are actually really cool. You can read about them a little bit here if you want. But for now, that is a very quick overview of my project that I've been working on for the past 2 quarters. And if you want to check it out, you can find it here at this address. So thanks for watching and listening, and I hope that you learned something.
Hi everyone, my name is Jose, and I've been working on this mixtape called Timeless for the past 6 months, and I'm really excited to present it to you. So the concept behind the mixtape is to combine aspects of bedroom pop and indie rock while adding my own style to it. I really wanted to play a lot with space, both sonically and lyrically. The goal is to create a chill rock album from outer space. I call this new genre bedroom space rock. To introduce myself, I am the audio engineer and producer behind the music, guiding the sonic world of the mixtape, and I had some help from my friends Jesus and Sam to do the guitar and vocal parts to accomplish my vision. So after a lot of writing, recording, editing, and mixing, we have the finished product of the Timeless demo. It consists of 7 songs with just a runtime of just over 17 minutes. This mixtape is meant to be listened to as a collection of moments in space. Each track is thoughtfully composed to create the genre of bedroom space rock. And here's an example of how I approached creating some of the music. This track is called LBHTH. I'll play the first track without any synthesizers in it, just some vocals, guitar, and drum stems.
They're fruit, but I hope I don't want you. And I hope I don't want you. But I'm too old to still not know.
In that clip, you could hear the guitar sustains for quite a while with some reverb, but it's still missing some important aspects to create this new genre and complete the vision of the project. So here are some synths that I put together to add to the song. And now here's the final product with both of them together. I went with an arpeggiated synth here to create a sound that gives a sense of science, aliens, and outer space. Something foreign from this world. and I added some airy synth chords to engage the listener into the sonic world of space. The reverb also creates both a sense of outer space and this grand sense of space within the mix itself. And here are some ways you can listen to the full project. It is available right now under my SoundCloud that's linked here along with a public Google Drive link. And after some final mastering touches, it will be uploaded to streaming services like Spotify, Tidal, Apple Music, etc. And here's a QR code that you can scan that will link you directly to the full demo on my SoundCloud. So yeah, thank you for tuning in to see my project. I'd like to thank Professor Shlomo for his help in producing the project and my peers for all their helpful comments along the way. And of course, the music department for allowing me to share my music with all of you. And so I'll play us out to the first song off the demo tape, Timeless.
Oh, right. Yes, yes. We are live. Hello, everybody. I am Eddie Ontiveros. I go by the performance name of Eddie East, and I am here to talk about Back to Reality, a concert I set up with Rendezvous with the Devil, Braulio.exe, and Christian Johnson that just also happens to be my senior project. Now, what exactly is Back to Reality? Well, back in the fall of 2020, I was in a course, with Shrok Yadagiri, who is also the senior project professor, and we were bringing out ideas of what we may possibly do for senior projects. And I was talking about how I wanted to possibly create a show where people could enter it, and hopefully people will enter it not because we are in the middle of a pandemic and we're not allowed to have audiences, but because they just want to watch it for the sake of listening to music. And my big thing was, well, if we were going to do this, how can we make it different from other live streams? And my thing is, well, when people look at concerts, sometimes they view recordings of concerts on YouTube. People who upload them, well, they do it in certain angles. And obviously it makes sense. People can't be running around at the concert going back and forth trying to find different angles and stuff. They just record it where they are and they upload to YouTube and it's recorded on the single. So my idea was, what if we did that, but with a live concert where people had the option to view the regular concert as is, or if they liked the left angle, the right angle, or the center angle, and that's how they wanted to view the concert, why not give them that option though? So when they enter the concert, they can experience it the way they would like to, so they can have an even better experience of that concert. And that was really our premise. From there, I asked Rendezvous with the Devil, so known as Levi here in the course, and Braulio.exe, aka Braulio, to help out with this performance as well to see what we could do. And thus we started rolling with the production of Back to Reality. So in week 7, myself and Levi both embarked on a journey back to UC San Diego. For myself, it was the first time that it had happened since about a year and a half, so that was really fun. And we performed right here at Middle of Mirror. For those who do not know where that is, if you go to the biology building area and you just keep going straight, go downstairs, it's right there. Please go ahead and support them. But yeah, week 7, we had our rehearsal set up and our performances. Cameras were set up left, right, and center. And I could not thank the Middle of Mirror enough for helping us set that up for an amazing concert and amazing hospitality for that. Well, then from there, from the finish of Braulio.exe's performance, we went on to send all of our videos to Brad Perez, who was the video editor for our piece. I thank him very much for doing that and taking time out of the quarter to do that. And had him video edit four recordings. One that would be a fully edited performance as if you were watching a regular live stream, and three other recordings that all were an hour long and consisting of strictly just one angle, one being left, one being right, and then one being center. From there, we took the videos and put them on this little helper right here called OneStream, which allows people to stream multiple streams on multiple social media platforms. And depending on the price, they range on the max that you can do. For our sake, we went to Facebook, YouTube, Twitch, and Instagram and uploaded all of them on June 4th and 5th. And that's going to be it for me. Thank you so much for checking out this video and being interested in it. And again, I would like to thank everybody who was a part of this project, Rendezvous with the Devil, Braulio.exe, Christian Johnson and his brand, I guess you could call it, Found Space, Brad Perez, the video editor, and Tate Smith. And I cannot wait to see how this project grows and how I use it in my future endeavors. Thank you, everybody, and I hope you have a good rest of your day, rest of your quarter, rest of your year, whenever you may be watching this.
Hello, everybody. My name is Nick Pendrick, and I also go by Nick Knight, and today I'll be presenting to you an EP that I've been working on since January of this year, and it was supposed to originally be an EP that's featuring artists from all around the city, because I've been a sound engineer running underground sessions for years, but this ended up turning out to kind of just be like an in-the-house type of EP, just due to moving circumstances and just a crazy year in COVID, and that kind of leads me to the title. Sleepless Nights is the title of my project, and that kind of just has a lot to do with just, you know what I mean, just overthinking things and staying up and being in your head. And I want to really just make it a goal of mine to really shed light on like mental illness and things like that when I'm moving forward with my career. So this project will be produced, mixed, mastered, and engineered by myself. And here it is, without further ado, I'm just gonna run through some of these.
Listen, why you not on me? You've been getting distant. We don't get freaky no more. Listen, why you not on me? Trying to see what's in store. Or if you don't want me no more, just say it. Just say it. Baby, just say it.
Just say it.
But stop playing with my heart. Just tell me what I gotta do to get me right next to you. I wanna show you what I used to do. Making you feel comfortable again.
need you as my best friend. Baby, send your location.
Location, baby.
You know that I'm waiting. Oh, girl, stop playing.
I'm playing.
That's all I'm saying.
That's all I'm saying.
But just know that I miss you. Thinking about the last time I kissed you. Something about something she lack. Her beauty is great, but the confidence ain't there. It's crazy, cause she got that bright curly hair.
I might tap out. Hell nah, that don't sound like me. I'm bringing them racks out, and I'ma spend them all on me. She wanna ride with me. She wanna ride with me. Well, I cover, that's not likely. Her nigga dressed just like.
So that is pretty much it. I just gave you guys a little sneak peek, some of the songs. Follow me on SoundCloud and Nick Knight. I'm just dropping them on SoundCloud for now because due to time restraints and going to UCSD, I didn't have the time to really curate this into an album. But anyway, it's out for you guys to listen. I appreciate you guys' support and for coming to watch. Thank you and have a good rest of your night.
Harmonic, wonderful. There was some discussion, I guess, Levi and Rachel, you want to talk about what you just talked in the chat? That would be great to talk about that a bit. Levi, you want to ask your question?
Yeah, so I was thinking about how the idea of sounds kind of playing with specific like actions in Python could be a really interesting way for people who are blind or visually impaired to use, in addition to like a screen reader or something like that. I feel like it'd be an accessible way for them to be able to use programming.
Yeah, definitely. So one of the goals of the project, one of the things I was thinking about when I first came up with the idea, is that not everybody's a visual learner. Some people like learn better in different ways, and some people are visually impaired. And because there are so many different like models for learning programming that are visual, which is great, but maybe some people would learn better with, you know, different ways, such as sound. So I thought it would be really interesting to try to make something like that.
Yeah, I was also wondering if you have, we had projects that are focused on games, and it sounded to me sort of a game-like experience, kind of the programming that becomes a story. So I was wondering if any of the game inspirations you had in this game?
Okay, yeah, sorry. I don't know what's going on with my camera. But yeah, I didn't really have a game inspiration or really any inspiration at all. A lot of these sounds, like I said in my presentation, they're kind of random sounds. So yeah, not really. I wasn't really going for a specific vibe or anything like that. It just ended up being the way that it was, just by trial and error and picking random things that sounded good. So.
Okay, yeah. Well, any of the other comments? I think there were in the chat a few people that mentioned you know, possible uses of this method for teaching for visually impaired or styles of learning. So I think that was definitely something that inspired many people. So any of the other chats or comments for the other projects? I think, yeah.
There is a question in the chat for Jose that says, creating a new genre is really cool. What inspired you to work with those specific genres and sounds?
Oh, yeah. So as an ICAM major, I knew that I was going to have to take this class and make like a body of work. So my friends and I already had some ideas of like what style of music we wanted to make, but because of the pandemic, a lot of the studios we thought we were gonna have access to like fell through. Like I didn't have any access to the studios at UCSD or through my internship. And then our contact in LA also fell through, all because of the restrictions. And so we were pretty bummed about like our goals. So the whole project had to like change. And then that's when I got the idea of, you know, just listening to music and like seeing like the bedroom pop genre just get pretty big. And like bedroom pop itself is just super inspired by the do-it-yourself like mantra. And so we like have this like little makeshift like studio that we built in my friend's house and just focus on like these raw elements of music and how we could turn this into something slightly different than what we're used to. And so, yeah, that's what inspired us to go that route.
Okay. Any other comments or questions to the presenters or from this group or previous groups? Okay. Well, wonderful. I think you're probably ready to move on to the next group. Jessica, would you want us to move on?
Hey, this is Braulio Segovia, aka Braulio.exe. Over the past 6 months, I'm working on my debut mixtape, Dirty, which dropped on all streaming platforms May 21st. I'm also in the virtual event, Back to Reality, where I performed my whole mixtape. Here are the first two songs off the tape.
I see plenty. I believe you'll see it too. Green to blue, red to purple, all together. Paint the pictures, see the movie fantasy. Slipping through the cracks, moving fast and normalized. Moving to you, see those angel eyes. Moving to you, see those.
You got it.
Fucking go.
I see two, one, two, let go, you two, watch out, let go.
This one's called At an Oxo. Oxo is like a 7-Eleven, but in like Mexico. Could be in South America too, I don't know, I haven't been there.
Been up for 3 days. Diners keep me up, I cannot go to bed. It don't really matter. I'm up, never tired.
Supercharged, I don't know. Another round, I'ma go. I got all of the time in my clip, just hit my line. Once again, I go rewind, get some sleep, and when I'm done, yeah, pam. All of them back, one more check. Coming in, little though, I'ma fuck up what I got. Send your pick, I got a lot. Send it up, marathon, that's when hit until it's gone. Wait.
Whew. Jump out the window, jump. Stay down, I've been low. Stock high with all the essentials.
Champagne was cheap, homie, got a double decker with a deal on it. Got two thick shades, don't see me, just dicking around before I ding dong ditch. So clean, just look, don't touch. Go loco for Cocoa Puffs. We'll be out, but ain't no fussing. Get back in time for Captain Crunch. Supercharged, I don't know. Woo! Another round, I'ma go. Woo! I got all of the time in my clip, just hit my line. Yes, again, I go rewind. Guess I'm sleeping with my motherfucking done. All of them back, one more. Check. Coming in, look, I'ma fuck. fuck up what I got. Send your pick, I got a lot. A marathon, that's one hit until it's gone. Supercharged, I don't know. Another round, I'ma go. Woo! I got all the time in my clutch, just hit my line. Once again, I go rewind. Get some sleep with my motherfucker done.
Woo! Woo! Got worked up on that one. Got worked the sweat.
Hello everybody, my name is Jonah Tam, and this is my EP project, Wasteful Pleasures. I've put a QR code here, and on the next slide, that links right to the project website, but other than that, let's get going. So, to mention what is on the website, you'll find everything from the equipment and software I used to pictures and videos I took documenting parts of the music making. I also have the different album covers I made, and all the demos I also made containing the progress for each song I made before the final result. So just to, before I get into the actual project, I just wanted to go over my influences and where I'm coming from musically for this project. Growing up in South Carolina during the 2000s and living on the West Coast 2010 onwards, I was exposed to a variety of hip-hop and electronic artists growing up, with some of my favorites being artists like Timbaland, Rat-A-Tat, MGMT, and Outkast. They, along with my parents, had great impacts on my musical tastes, as if they showed me lots of progressive and southern rock, along with some country and folk. So to get to the actual concept for this album, I originally wanted to speak on some of the feelings I've had thinking about modern life and the effects social technology has had on us individually and socially up until now. I just wanted to make something that speaks on the questions like, what is it like having to exist in the physical and digital at once? What's left of a person's identity when the screens are turned off, things like that. And I titled it Wasteful Pleasures because I wanted to put a name on the moments of time we lose when indulging in the digital instead of being in the real, like being able to only do things that are enabled only by technology. So how did this concept turn out? So as I was creating it, and about halfway through, I started just having kind of these moments of anxiety and fear. I sort of took over when thinking about the end of the project and how it could affect me. I definitely believe the isolation had a great contributing factor to these thoughts, because it's much different being able to go to the UCSD studio versus having to just be at home, but I still like what I ultimately ended up with. I mean, I'm still slightly disappointed that the time and environment didn't match up to allow me to have the confidence to take it all the way, but that's all right. So what did I do instead? Well, my project ended up becoming altered. So I still wanted to focus on the concept of being emotionally impacted by social technology, but I instead wanted to think about how these emotions, about the emotions themselves rather than the problems. So what did my project end up becoming? While I still wanted to focus on the concept of being emotionally impacted by social technology, I instead wanted to think about these emotions rather than the problems themselves. I basically had to ask myself, how can my music distract others like me from the modern feelings and issues? Thinking about these sounds and these genres I grew up with, I basically created a record that just kind of celebrates the feeling of what it would feel like not having to deal with these modern problems. So for this presentation, I decided to showcase my song Echo Traps as the main feature. Being the longest of the four I've made for the project, I really feel like it encapsulates the overall feeling of the project, both emotionally and sonically. Thank you. All right, so here I just wanted to mention the plugins that were really essential during this whole project. For many of the synths I used came out of the Core Collection, with the Triton, the Monopoly, and the MS-20 being some favorites of mine. When doing the percussion, I actually wanted to find something new. I wanted a way of being able to have really good control over the sound shaping and expression of the sounds with a sequencer all in one. I found UVI's drum designer was a great choice, and it really helped with making the drum sound more alive and real. For all my EQ and filtering fab filters, plugins like Pro Q3 and Volcano 2, pretty much my bread and butter on every channel that I used. As for effects and everything else, I just used mostly a combination of plugins from Soundtoys, Waves, and Arteria. And just to talk about the album art for a second, here I created multiple covers over the course of the project just to try and capture the feelings of the music and what it was I wanted to represent visually. It took me actually until near the end of the project that I was finally able to center in on the idea for the image. After thinking about how to represent the visual space I created in the music and what lighting and colors would create that kind of isolated club environment. So what did I learn at the end of all of this? Well, I read this quote at the top here somewhere a couple weeks ago, and it just really stuck with me, and I think I know why. Going through the pressures I experienced at a time like this during this project made me realize the importance of having someone there supporting you. This kind of isolation really exposed me to the downsides of not having someone right there musically, right there in your corner when it comes to music. I mean, it's one thing to be able to do all this by myself, and I'm glad for the experience, but I definitely think that going forward, I need to start creating music with others if I'm going to make anything meaningful. So that's it. Thanks for listening. I hope this project seemed interesting. Again, if you want to check out the rest of the project and listen to the other three tracks, this QR code will take you right to the website. Thank you.
Oh hey, that's actually me right there that you're watching right now. My name is Adrian Villalobos, and I'm here to present on what I have worked on for my senior project. This will actually include the different processes, planning, implementation, and challenges that I came across when completing this. So before we take a look at my project, I kind of wanted to explain my background a bit more, and hopefully that will allow for some more context and more reasoning behind the different decisions I made for my project. So in regards to my final project, I actually do have a background and interest in audio engineering and also music production. And actually in the time I'm putting together this video, I do have an associate's degree in audio engineering. And I'm also currently wrapping up my bachelor's, which mainly focuses on music technology, which is pretty much the culmination of all things audio, music, sound, and technology. So now let's start from the beginning. Okay, maybe not that far back. Let's say the beginning of this year. So at the beginning of this year, I kind of decided I wanted to tackle two main points that I wanted to reflect onto this project. I actually decided on these with the thought that they would help benefit me and my future work endeavors. This would ultimately end up being building a stronger online presence and having material that I can show to potential clients and employers. So to achieve these simple goals, I took it upon myself to engage with some not so simple project ideas. I actually settled upon three key goals that would make up the bulk of my project. The creation of a personal website slash portfolio, video content creation, and settling upon and being comfortable with my position as an audio engineer and music producer. Now that I've covered and handed you all this information, let's take a look at each of these individual goals a bit more in depth. So in this homepage that also doubles as my credit page is a hub that houses many of my past, current, and future projects. You can see various audio projects that I've assisted with, either in an audio engineer role or as a producer. I also included a SoundCloud with more mixing examples and personal solo projects that I have produced myself. I also included a detailed bio which includes two different language translations, a radio playlist that I made which I update monthly which includes a small blog on why I chose those tracks just to kind of give more exposure to underground and indie artists, and a contact tab to easily reach me. As mentioned previously, the site would be home to different assets and projects, of which mentioned is video content. This has taken the form of a YouTube channel, but it will also be regularly updated on the previously mentioned site. To have you guys get a feel for the type of content I like to produce, here's a sketch I made for a video about entry-level gear that I released a couple weeks ago.
Upgrade-itis, the wallet killer. Upgrade-itis affects those who do not take the correct precautions when informing and buying themselves pieces of audio gear.
Wow, what are the symptoms of upgrade-itis?
Well, Johnny, here are some helpful signs you and your friend should look out for. Irritability towards gear. Anxiousness to complete projects. Restlessness due to constant online window shopping. Cramped hands in credit card holding position.
Gee whiz, what can cause upgrade-itis?
Well, Johnny, studies at our lab show these possible causes. Failure to read the gear's manual and learn their gear properly. Failure to take care of and store gear in their proper environments.
Holy moly! How can I prevent this horrible disease?
Ha 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 ha! Fear not, Johnny, for there are some cures to help prevent upgrade-itis.
Familiarize yourself with your current gear. Yes, this includes reading the manual. Make the most out of your current gear. Avoid parodying websites and YouTubers with big wallets telling you what expensive gear you should put yourself in debt for.
If you take all these steps, you can prevent upgrade-itis.
Wow, you really think so?
Ha 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 ha. Maybe, little Johnny. Maybe.
So this final goal of mine is actually not as tangible as, say, video content or a website. It's actually something I kind of wanted to explore as more of a personal goal, to which actually this project helped me achieve. So basically, this would be me kind of settling upon and being comfortable with my position as an audio engineer and music producer, and I can actually touch upon this a bit more. So like I mentioned, this goal isn't as tangible as, say, video content or website. It's basically me being more comfortable and seeing how I've grown since I started the project. So for example, just kind of how I approach a mix, or how I record, or the different songs I like, or generally like the video topics I kind of go over, I think all these things kind of culminate into me reflecting a bit more about my profession and what I like to do. Ultimately, the other projects I've worked on, such as the video content and the website, do allow me to kind of further reflect and expand upon my skills, which in turn can actually help open up new opportunities. So now, unfortunately, we are at the end of the video, but I do hope you learned a bit more about me, what I do, and what I hope to accomplish with this project. If you'd like to visit or see any of these projects I worked on, feel free to do so with these links. Overall, it was an amazing experience to really be able to take a step back and see how I'm able to explore these different creative methods, to not only become better in my craft, but also allow others to see how I reach these goals. So with that, I say thank you for watching.
Hi everyone, my name is Siri. And for my senior project, I bring an EP called The New Beginning that has three songs in it. They are all hip-hop songs, but with different types. The reason why I call it The New Beginning is that, first of all, it represents a new beginning for my music career. And then it means a new beginning for my life starting from this year, since last year was tough. And also, I have seen some biases towards international students last year, so I would like to point them out and provide a new perspective for the listeners. That is also a new beginning for them. And all right, here's a SoundCloud page for my EP. And my first song is called By and High, which simply means say goodbye to the tough time in 2020 and move on to 2021 with a positive attitude. And due to the time constraint, I'm not able to play the whole songs, and you can listen to them on SoundCloud page later.暂停，该抛开枷锁，找到新的目标，继续前行。为你的离开不平，总感觉有些莫名。毕业的季节，偏偏却让泪水流个不停。感谢有你愿意途经我的世界，那陪你走到终点，也该说声再见。就让思绪随着时间对它祭奠，还有些期待未来路上会与谁的碰面。或许这段经历听来不算刻骨铭心，但对我来说意义如同三藏求取真经。你走后我的歌声也不知道唱给谁听，路灯拉长的剪影透露些许孤苦伶仃。熬夜学到崩溃，听过一云到心碎，空管东倒西歪散落身边陪我喝醉。孤独无色无味，却把我防线击溃，放眼望去周围没有谁能给我安慰。记
住我呼啸的故事情节，随时间洋洋洒洒化作云烟。
Okay, and then the second one is called IS Monologue. IS here is an abbreviation, which means international students. And for this song, I mentioned the biases we have faced and how we feel about them.
Yay!Yeah, let me tell you something. 不知从何时起，人们戴上六色眼镜，看待留学生群体从不保留一丝理性，键盘慎重完成拿与生俱来的使命，红着眼的样子像得乐于直播的病，不就是啃着老的富二代在镀金，花钱大手大脚赚钱从不用心，芝麻大的砍头要会下班就边找就行的行为，真让我们无比痛心。这些话谁说过心里都知道，各大社交平台上面发起冲锋号，生病来去谁让你们不去喝中药，我们出事你却躲在被窝偷偷笑，笑着前段时间新闻中被报道出的枪击，笑着 A 声黑的同时若无其事喝着香槟，笑着口味传遍美国，我们在外无人相依，没有笑料就笑我们，即便回顾也没出息。
Okay, and the last song is called Footprints, which records my 8-year life in California. I wrote most of the places I have been to and the memorable experiences in this song.And to keep the memories.
Come ride with me, oh, 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 尘封的记忆恍惚在潮汐，老式照相机放作是抽屉，过去的经历风雨的意义，留下的足迹藏有我的秘密。Come ride with me, oh, come ride with me, oh, come ride with me, oh, come ride with me, oh.
So that's it, and thanks for watching, and hope you enjoy them, and bye bye.
Hello everyone, my name is Yufi Zhao,
and I am a fourth year student of ICAM Music. I am interested in UI UX design, and I wanted to do some research on UI sound design related to the overall user experience. I've done two separate parts for this research. Besides the general background studies, I made two short video demos of interaction sound for the Jinjin Impact game, and I conducted an experiment about the effect of background music in the Flappy Bird game. I chose game as the platform because game contains much more interactive actions as well as receiving more information, so that game is one of the best representations of human-computer interaction. Here is a short video that I captured from Genshin Impact game. Right now, try to imagine the UI sound that each action should have. Right now, let's listen to the version A of UI sound.
Oh! 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 Oh!
Now let's hear the version B. According to the demos, it is not hard to see the essential relationship between sound and human perception and cognition. Each auditory event can be perceived as a sign carrier by which information about the world is communicated. So sound design decisions are taken on the basis of how listeners perceive sounds and how the perceptual event occurs for a certain communication in the real world. On the other hand, users would expect that the sound should have a world and associate meaning with the event. So we have to make sure that the design sound match with the existing universal and natural environmental events for users. Besides the UI sound, I conducted a small experiment on background music and game. Flappy Bird game is used in this experiment. And this flowchart simply describes how this game works and the logistics of the background music. Now I'm going to show you my selected background music sample for this experiment. Just like the demo, I tested it with three subjects. There were three pairs of game settings. All the codes were the same except that the selected background music was different for each Pygame file. Each pair was randomly selected and so did the speeding of the music. According to the result, background music that has increasing speed can potentially help subjects gain better scores. And background music that does not sound harsh or nervous can potentially lead subjects to higher scores. Also, subjects have reported that rounds that played with trap music were the hardest and played with the jazz music were the easiest. And also, as the music speeded up, the game speeded up too. But in fact, the speed of the game remains the same. From this research, I found that UI sound is truly a fact human-computer interaction experience. Also, I found that there is a deep relationship between UI sound, visual representation, and human perception and cognition. In the future, I want to dig deeper into the HCI and make better user experience, not only on the software but also the hardware.
I think you're muted, Shlomo.
Thank you. Okay, well, it's I think Sherrick and myself, I think are grateful to the students for the opportunity to basically be part of your journey. And thank you everybody for, you know, doing this amazing kind of, I don't even have to say, I mean, for me, I mean, I'm just going to talk a little bit about my own personal experience now. When I'm kind of here, the project, at least the ones that I've been involved with and spent time, I think for me, this is kind of what made this year go, right? In the Corona time, having the chance to spend time and dive into these projects, it was really meaningful. And I think, you know, the sincerity, the effort, the sensibility, and you know, the intellectual inquiry, the artistic search, I think it was all there. And it takes so much to get to this level of execution and this level of depth, which I think is really fortunate to have such an opportunity to work with you guys. And that's really amazing. So thank you, everyone. And and if we have any kind of discussion or thoughts as a conclusion, I'll be happy to hear from everyone. I know, Sherrick, if you would like to say a few words.
Sure, I should also thank everybody, thank all the students who shared the work. It's truly a privilege, you know, to work with you. This was not an easy year. And Jonah and Siri, thanks for bringing up the difficult issues of this year. You know, as artists, we always face difficult situations. It's never easy. And it's always finding the new path, finding the new way, and also reflecting the human condition, reflecting where we stand. And I think this both physically, socially, culturally, politically, whatever we do has to reflect where we're going. The sound of the music is the future of us. So truly, it was a pleasure, a privilege to be part of your pieces. This is the best part of the teaching that we do. For me, it's this, I come alive, I learn about you, and we learn about the work that you have done. And needless to say, you guys have a really fantastic future, and we hope to hear from you. We hear what you go about all your endeavors. So thanks, everybody. And also thanks to Jessica and our production team for making this process really easy for us. It was really fantastic. A great year.
Yes, indeed. Thank you so much, Jessica and the production team. Okay, anybody would like to say some final words or?
Yeah, please share with us. We didn't talk about these last pieces. We
a lot of interesting comments going on the chat, on the YouTube discussion. So, and we'll have a chance to revisit this recording, right, on YouTube. It will be stored. Jessica, would you like to conclude our session as the person who produced this show?
Yeah, Jessica, okay. My mic was not muted, so they do hear you on YouTube.
Yes. All right. Yeah. Okay, well, congratulations, everyone. And thank you, everybody. And good luck with your new careers and the future that I think is waiting for everyone of you.